So with that, I would like to turn over the discussion for Atheist One, Truman Smith.
Okay, I'll need that slide up. Also, I had handouts. I'm sorry, I didn't have enough, though. If you're not going to keep your handout, you might want to, if you don't need to bring it home, might as well just leave it on your chair and then we'll use it in a second service. Okay, so I was a born-again Christian. Next slide, slide two. I was a born-again Christian for over 25 years. I left primarily for two scientific reasons, biological evolution and neurology. And, you know, if you say, well, I know God exists because I just feel him in my heart, I have a personal relationship with Jesus, I was also there, and now I see it as a delusion, just to, to share you from my perspective. Next page. So what does an atheist think? I just want to be clear here. This is not to mock anybody's beliefs, but this is how it really is in my mind. In my mind, God doesn't exist just like, God does not exist in heaven. Jesus is not in heaven, just like Santa Claus is not at the North Pole. To me, they're both imaginary characters. And one time somebody said, well, okay, you don't believe in God, what about Satan? It's like, Satan, same thing, Darth Vader. I don't believe there are any haunted houses. You know, try to find a haunted house sometime for real and see if you can sleep there overnight or something. I'd love to test it, but you can never find them if you really want to test these. Next page. So why not believe in God? What evidence is there not to believe in God? There's two ways to approach this. One way is the Christian can say it's reasonable to believe in God and here's my evidence. And I would say that evidence is not good. The other way to approach it is I could say I actually have evidence that shows God does not exist. And I think there's lots of good evidence items like that. Okay, so for the Christian who says, well, here's some evidence for God, this is what Pastor Ron's going to be talking about, I believe a lot of that largely falls into a logical fallacy called the appeal to ignorance. And what that means is when they say things like, well, okay, everything came from the Big Bang, but who started the Big Bang? Therefore, you need God. Well, nobody knows. That's not evidence for either side. That's called the appeal to ignorance when you say, nobody knows this, therefore God. That's kind of like saying, nobody knows who did the tsunami, therefore, you know, God did it. But now we know tsunamis are caused by earthquakes, caused by plate tectonics. You know, even Pat Robertson said after the Haiti earthquake that the Haitians deserted because of a pact with the devil. It has nothing to do with that, it's just plate tectonics. Next line. And by the way, there is lots of positive evidence out there in DNA, for example, that bears on these arguments, but the Christians usually don't bring those up. Bart is a rare exception we'll talk about later here, where he's bringing up actual evidence, which is a good intellectual discussion to have. One of the problems against the belief in God, one of the evidences against God, just one of many, is a traditional one called the problem of evil. And since evolution, now we know is a fact, this actually greatly magnifies the problem because, you know, for millions of years, there's all this pain and suffering in evolutionary processes, in the survival for life. They say nature is red in tooth and claw. Basically, the gazelle, the speed of the gazelle is shaped by the leopard. Next line, or the cheetah, I mean. So this is only a problem for Christians too, this problem of evil, because the idea is, why is there pain and suffering in light of a good and all good and all powerful God, all loving God, especially one who says, well, I designed everything through evolution because it's a very painful, messy process. The problem is a philosophical problem where there's a conflict between what we see in reality and this good and all loving, all knowing, all good God. If you're a naturalist like me, think nature is all there is, there's no problem. Nature is what you expect to see. You don't expect to be somebody up there taking care of you or looking over things. So there's usually two general categories, natural evil and moral evil. Natural evil would be like this, the 2004 tsunami that killed a couple hundred thousand people and made a few million people homeless. Imagine all the pain and suffering involved in that. And then a moral evil would be like Hitler killing 6 million Jews. What is God doing while 6 million Jews are being slaughtered, plus all the other evils that came out of that? So some attempted theologies, you know, blame it on Adam and Eve, can't do it because evolution disproves Adam and Eve. Blame it on free will, can't do that because Romans 9:21 says...
15 seconds left, Truman.
Okay, free will is not important to God. Let's skip this slide and go on to the next slide. Some of these you just have to read. They basically admit there is no good answer for it. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Truman. Ron?
One reason I believe God exists is because it makes more sense for me to believe in a creator-designer than to believe the universe evolved by chance over billions of years. For if something exists, we must affirm one of three things. Either it is eternal, it is created by something that is eternal, or it's self-created. Take this chair, for example. Either I believe that the best conclusion is that there was a chair maker. If there's not a chair maker, then I have to believe either that this chair has always existed, it's really old, I probably shouldn't be sitting in it, or that at some point the molecules of the universe joined themselves together and built themselves into a chair. Well, likewise, I believe our world is way too complex to believe it came into existence by chance. Consider the temperature. The sun is 12,000 degrees Fahrenheit. All the Earth's heat comes from the sun. We are 93 million miles away from the sun, just the right distance. If the planet was 50 degrees cooler or 50 degrees hotter, all existence would cease on this planet. Why is the sun 12,000 degrees hot? Why isn't it 120 degrees? Why isn't it 120,000 degrees? Why isn't it twice as far away? Because all life would perish. Is this by chance or by design? Consider rotation. This planet rotates 365 times a year as it passes around the sun. Suppose it rotated 36 times. Well, our days and nights would be, you know, 10 times as long. We'd be terribly hot on one side and unbearably cold on the other. And life would begin to disappear. Is this by chance or by design? What about the air? Oxygen constitutes 21% of the air. Why not 4%? Why not 10%? Why not 50%? Well, if it was 50% oxygen, the first time someone lit a match, we'd all be on fire. Is 21% by chance? Our universe is intricately designed. The human mind, the eye, the ear, the hand, DNA are all too complex for me to believe that they came by chance. For me, the best explanation of the intricately designed human body and our amazing world is that there was a designer, hence God. Another reason I believe in God is because of the universal sense of right and wrong. After World War II, we conducted the Nuremberg trials to judge the leaders of Germany for their actions. They were conducted on the assumption that there is a standard behavior, which is obvious to everyone. If there is no standard, then all the things said at the trials were nonsense. What's the point of saying the enemy is wrong if right is not a real thing? How can we blame Syria for using weapons of mass destruction if there is no universal standard of right and wrong? Suppose you hear a cry for someone in danger. You'll probably feel two things. One, a desire to help. The other, a desire to stay away and keep yourself safe. But in addition to those two desires, you will feel something else, another impulse that says, even though you'd probably rather stay away, keep yourself safe, you ought to help this person. This is that universal sense of right and wrong. Now, if there's a God who established right and wrong based on his nature and planted it in our hearts, it all makes perfect sense. But if there is no God and we all evolve from random molecules, how do you account for morality? Darwinism doesn't answer why there's morality. Atheists will say morality is disguised selfishness. Why does the mom jump into a car to save her little boy? She's saving her genes. Why is a businessman kind to a patron? To get his business. It's the survival of the fittest. But why do I give up my seat on the max to an 85-year-old woman? So I can get her seat next week? Why should I do anything for anybody if they're all just a random combination of molecules? They have no ultimate meaning. This innate sense of right and wrong suggests to me that there is a God to whom we must give an account.
I'm done. You're done 30 seconds early. Good job. Make my job easy. All right, so the next speech here will be a two-minute response from either one of you two. So who will take it?
Okay. So Truman, you suggest the Holocaust and the tsunami in 2004 would suggest that either God is not good to allow something that horrible to happen, or he's not all powerful, or he would have prevented it, or God doesn't exist at all. I believe God does exist, and he's all good, and he's all powerful. He could protect us from all evil, but in his wisdom, he has chosen not to. God wants to have a relationship with us. He loves us. He wants us to love him in return. But God knows you can't force love. And the only way you can have love is if you give a person freedom. And I believe that 95% of evil that we see today in the world is the result of human freedom. Poor choices, wars, holocausts, you can't blame those things on God. Rape, murders, burglaries, gang shootings, we can't blame those things on God. I mean, even earthquakes, hurricanes, tsunamis, and volcanoes, people have to take some credit for choosing to live on fault lines next to volcanoes, living on beaches, or living at low sea level where they're likely to be flooded, or living in shoddy housing so an earthquake happens and the structures collapse and everyone dies. Maybe the person's not wrong. Maybe it's the builder who put up the shoddy construction. But humans have to take some responsibility. God cannot give freedom of choice and withhold it at the same time. So 95% is due to evil choices of human freedom. The other 5%, I just believe God, in his wisdom, allows evil to happen, knowing that it will maybe cause us to want to choose him. If everything's perfect in our world, we have no problems, why would we ever turn to God? And without evil happening in the world, how would we ever build up character qualities like endurance, courage, self-sacrifice, and compassion?
Okay, so response from one of you two.
Okay, you ready to share it or just... Okay. So he said don't blame God for tsunamis. I'm not blaming God for tsunamis. Again, the problem of evil is a conflict between God's nature, all good and all powerful, all loving, versus what we observe. And you said, it sounded like you're saying your primary response was because of free will. Like I said, in Romans, that's disqualified. That's not a biblical answer. It says God can make, he's a potter, he can make a pot for any vessel he wants to. He doesn't value free will. So to say free will, it's a non-biblical answer. It's against the Bible. And furthermore, that has nothing to do with, that's a moral answer. It has nothing to do with the natural evils, such as tsunamis. Let's see what else here. Okay, go ahead.
I think one other point, I very much agree with you on people taking responsibility for their lives and their choices. That's one of the reasons why I really like you as a person. I do believe you need to take that one step further, and there is a moral compass that does not necessarily have to come from God. You can start with empathy, you can start liking your family and your neighbors and your friends. That's a very good moral compass. I don't think you need a God for that. And the one point where I strongly disagree, if talking about bad things happening, yes, people build their houses on fault lines, and that might be a stupid decision. A little kid that is subject to a child rape, for example, did not make that choice. It did not make a good or a bad choice or anything, and quite honestly, it makes me mad, emotionally very mad, to think that there is an all-powerful God out there that sees that and does nothing. He just lets it happen.
Well, I would admit that it is tough to see so many horrible things happen and you're left wondering, what's God doing? You said that, Truman. But again, I would contend that God, in his wisdom, knows that we have to have freedom if we're going to have if we're going to actually love him and respond to him. And that was the price worth paying, allowing there to be evil. And as to, we can all have morality, even whether or not we believe in God, I still think that makes more sense to believe in God. I mean, what's the point? If we're all random molecules come together and we have no ultimate destination, there's no point. Why should I care about anybody else? There's no real strong basis for that.
Ask your heart. Okay, are you finished?
Oh, yeah. Probably.
So let's donate two more minutes for your side of Chris or Truman.
Okay, did you want
to
also...
Just ask
your question. Well, I wanted to start. Did you want to also...
Yeah.
Okay. There's no basis, he said, for morality in an atheist system. Really, I mean, I think there's three guidelines or principles. One is consequentialism, which you know what's good and right based on the consequences that could follow from it. This is using your head to thinking about moral questions. The other one is reciprocity. You know, I'll be good to you, so you can be good to me, and this makes a better world, more pleasurable. The other one's individual rights, giving people the right to do what they want as long as they don't hurt anybody else. These are philosophical moral principles. To say, well, morals really come from God, and I find it for the Bible, God said it, therefore it is, you don't think at all. It's just written for you. That's not a good way of thinking. I mean, it's not a mature way of thinking. So there is a substantial foundation, and those three things I mentioned.
Yeah, that's an interesting point to connect there. If you do follow your heart, reciprocity, trying to make a better world, you define the purpose of your life. You yourself, it's back to you have that responsibility. Don't give responsibility to a pastor, to a book, to something else. You are responsible for your life, for the choices that you make, for the decisions that you make, for the moral compass that you follow. And all of you follow your own moral compass, even while reading the Bible. The Old Testament and parts of the New Testament have statements in them that none of you would follow. You would not stone your son for not obeying you. You don't. You follow your moral compass. You make that decision every day. Just go one step further, as I said in the preparation meetings, jokingly, Bart, you're as atheist as I am, you just stop one God short. I went one God further. That's all the difference.
Finished?
Yeah.
Okay, so this is the end of the first block. So at this point, as I mentioned, we'd like to ask for questions from the audience. So Peter, if you can help me, the first question will be for the either one of the Christian panel. Any hints? Could you come up to the? Come up to the.
Do I really need a microphone?
Yeah.
Yeah, so everybody can hear you, please. Okay, I'll give you 1 minute to ask the question. Okay.
Do you really think that man's brain, just that part of his body, was an accident?
Okay, so that would have been for the Christian side, but your question is for the.
Okay, so by accident you mean there was nobody there to plan it? Yes. There is no creator God. That's what I believe, yes. If you look at brains, if you look across all the different animal species, you can see how the brain is more complex and they do more complex things based on their brain. So you can see the emergence of the mind when you look at different animal species. For example, we use tools, other animals use tools. We even play and have some fun, other animals play and have fun. We have a language, animals have rudimentary languages. We can see so much, it makes perfectly sense that we arose just like any other animal.
And that was an accident.
No, I don't think it was an accident. I will actually have a slide or two on that one. I think what we do share with you is that we're very amazed about the complexity that has evolved, and it took quite a long time to get to that point. But there's definite rules how evolution took place and how something as complex as the human brain, including self-consciousness, has evolved. It's not an accident.
Okay, yeah, we went a little off course there, but that's okay, we're still within the 2 minutes. So can we get a question towards the Christian side? Okay, come up to the microphone, please.
This is for each of one. I this is for each of one. Where do you think evil comes from?
Rob, can we get an answer from the Christian side first?
Well, God has given freedom to humans to do good or to do evil, to choose God or to reject Him. And so evil comes from our choice to do evil. God also gave the angels freedom. And we are told that one-third of the angels chose to disobey God and depart from heaven. And so evil comes from them as well.
Yeah.
Just to give a quick definition, let's say, for example, first there's good and bad. If you went out here and told you $1 million, we'd all say, well, you have a good day today. If you went out there and got killed in a car accident, we would say you had a bad day today. I like how Christopher Hitchens says evil is Evil is going overboard with bad. For example, if you mug somebody and take their money, that's bad. But if you stab them 100 times, kick them in the face, and then throw their body around and run them over with the car, that's evil. That's going the extra mile. So by evil, that's what I meant. It's just incredible.
So you don't believe there is a devil that it was sin, man fell, and then...
Right. According to evolution, there is no such thing as a first human, because humans evolved over a population and through time. So there is no like human being born from an ape.
So if people evolved and were good to start with, why aren't they good now?
15 seconds left on this one.
Well, I wouldn't say they were good to begin with. Nature is nature. You can observe animals in the nature being good to each other and also being mean to each other. And we have more complex brains, so we can formulate it. We have moral philosophy now because of our more complex brains. We can think
okay,
about it.
We're done here, so we're going to move same format to the second block. And in this case, Bart is going to start us off in about 5 minutes.
What's the question?
The question is, did humans evolve from other animals? So, Bart?
Next slide, please. All right, evolution is descent with modification from a common ancestor. The modifications are random changes of DNA and natural selection of better mutants. From this, it is claimed man evolved over billions of years. There are two types of evolution. Microevolution is small changes within kind, such as dog breeds. Macroevolution, or evolution, is the belief that one species can give rise to a different species and has no evidence. There are two types of theories or beliefs. There are scientific beliefs which are testable and have evidence. You can do a test or experiment to demonstrate that the Lipitor you take lowers your blood cholesterol. Non-scientific or faith-based beliefs also can be true but are not testable and have no observable evidence. This includes historical information. You cannot do a test or experiment to show that General Grant won many battles in the Civil War, but we believe it based on faith that the written documents are true, just as we believe that the Bible is true based on its written documentation. Evolution is not a science because its claim of changes occurring over billions of years is by nature not testable, and there is no evidence that evolution has produced different species which are unable to mate with each other or are more complex, such as having more body parts. It is claimed that you can test evolution by making predictions about what is found in nature, but this is not enough to be science. For example, I can test the theory that life could spontaneously generate in a few weeks, since it would predict maggots to appear on dead meat within a few weeks. I can test the theory that the sun revolves around the earth, since it would predict the sun to rise in the east and set in the west. I can test the theory of evolution, since it would predict different transitional fossils of varying age and DNA similarities. And I can test the theory that Martians mated with Earthlings every 1,000 years, since it would also predict different transitional fossils and varying age and DNA similarities. Any nonsense theory can predict an outcome. Real scientific evidence is showing the outcome was caused by the theory. Evolutionists simply cite outcomes such as fossil and DNA similarity, but they fail to show evolution as its cause. They argue evolution is the most plausible answer. But what makes an answer plausible? Answer, it's prior experience. You see a destroyed trailer park in Oklahoma. There are no witnesses. Was it caused by a firecracker or a tornado? Even though there were no witnesses to this destruction, a tornado was plausible because of witnesses to prior tornado destruction. A firecracker isn't plausible because no one has ever seen firecrackers cause destruction to this degree. Likewise, evolution isn't a plausible answer for origins because no one has ever seen it cause changes to the degree claimed. No study really demonstrates evolution. In my research, and I researched about 400 scientific references of evolution, 20% simply show microevolution, which are small changes within a species, and the rest are simply descriptions of physiologic systems of various species with their evolution only assumed. And I have a video, if it'll come up, Pat. No video? There was a problem with assuming.
You should never assume, because when you assume, you make an ass of you and me.
All right. So, next is evolution is impossible because life depends on molecules to interact with each other. An example of intermolecular fit is insulin function. It's a hormone protein that it binds to an alpha receptor, which attaches to a beta receptor, which must be properly oriented within the cell wall. So is it possible for the insulin alpha receptor to evolve to fit both insulin and its beta receptor? The DNA gene for the alpha receptor is 2,193 nucleotides long. It consists of four nucleotides arranged in a specific pattern analogous to a computer code. Evolutionists believe there was an ancestral receptor, but if that receptor just needed to change its five amino acids to fit both insulin and the other receptor, the odds this could happen could be calculated by counting for the four nucleotides and the gene size, and you get one chance in 5 × 10⁻¹⁹. So, since mutations are random and molecules need to fit each other, and since DNA codes for molecules can be hundreds of nucleotides long, it is statistically impossible to mutate the proper DNA sequences to obtain functioning, fitting molecules. Evolution is a faith-based, not science or evidence-based theory. Atheism's superiority claim over Christianity is science, but since atheist science is pseudoscience, this claim is void.
Okay, we're moving on to Chris at this point.
Yeah. Did humans evolve from other animals? Bart is very courageously questioning an accepted theory. Evolution, as a definition, is the change in inherited characteristics, so inheritance comes in there, of biological populations. And that's an important point. We're talking about a gene pool over successive generations, and there is proof even for macroevolution. But it took E. coli bacteria about 30,000 generations to actually show that evolution. Next slide. Evolution is a fact. The National Academy of Science Institute of Medicine in 2008 said specifically, biologists agree that descent with modification, aka evolution, is one of the most reliably established facts in science. So life on Earth, all life on Earth, started a good 3.8 billion years ago from a universal ancestor or a couple of them, but mostly it is believed that is one organism actually, or organism-like creature. It wouldn't even fit today's definition of an organism. And repeated speciation and divergence of life, all the complexity that we see nowadays, are basically can be inferred from all the sets of biochemical morphological traits that we see evolved over that time. Probabilities, Ron said very much in the beginning, just seeing all the complexity out there makes me believe in a God. I wonder at the complexity also. I admire it. I think our world is fantastic that we live in. If you just look at what different types of cabbages you can basically, through artificial selection in that case, or different dog types, Bart had that as an example, over just a couple of hundred generations, we're not talking thousands of generations, the complexity that we can create already with this very small little playing field, if you give world a couple of billion years to evolve, you will see that complexity, and that's exactly what we experience in biological life. What you also see, and that's a little answer to Bart's posture that he says it's so highly unlikely, it's so highly improbable. I would say yes, it's highly unlikely that we specifically live in the Goldilocks zone where exactly the temperatures are between boiling water and freezing water. That was sheer luck. That life started on this planet, that really was luck. If you take the number of planets, there's about a billion inhabitable planets in this universe. We were just lucky to be on this one where it is. There's a lot of them out there that simply are not in that zone. We were just the lucky ones. That, yes. About evolution and about specific traits, specific, for example, receptor peptides evolving specifically for insulin, for example, if you take the mere size of that gene pool that you're modifying, and looking at the presentation that Bart made, I asked myself, okay, how big is one of those pools? And I started investigating how many insects live out there on this world right now, right this moment. And the figure that I came across in 3-4 studies, incidentally, is also 10 to the power of 19, which means your probabilities are 1. It's pretty darn sure that it's going to happen and that it's going to fit. Next slide, please. Evidence, Bart says, evolution is not science. It's not scientific. We're not talking about common sense. We're talking about science, and there is a difference. Without trying to sound nerdy or so, but common sense tells us that the Earth is flat. It's sitting still. I don't feel any motion. Any of you feel any motion? We should be sitting still. We're not going around the sun. That's common sense. Once you start to infer from other observations that are not directly experienceable, you realize that, no, we are moving. There's a reason that we don't feel that motion, because the atmosphere moves with us and the gravity keeps us pulling downwards, but we are moving around the sun. Although, interestingly enough, nobody has watched that yet. Even our astronauts that are out there, they can't really watch that, because it's a process that takes about a year to get around it. There's a lot more scientific discoveries that are unobservable. I assume, Bart, even in your med school times, you never saw a germ head-on. You used some microscope or other device, so some indirect measurement, some inference there. Atoms, electrons, all of us using cell phones are using scientific discoveries that weren't made with direct observation, but through inference. Next slide. The scientific method, you're criticizing evolution for not being scientific. Well, we make observations, you see complexity of life in humans and in chimps, for example, and you say, hey, if evolution was the cause for that, if natural selection after
15 seconds.
Modifications brought to that, then, next slide please, then we should actually find, one more, we should find something that was between chimps and humans leading to a common ancestor that we had in the past. And we actually did find those. That prediction was made 130 years ago, and we did find, in the meantime, those transitional pieces between chimp-like, more human-like, and actually a common ancestor that we share with apes. We didn't evolve from them, we share that. Thank you.
Let's move on. So the next point is a response from the atheist panel towards Bart's presentation.
Do you want to add some to my response that I already made?
Okay. Well, just was this response? Okay, yeah, response to Bart. Okay, so Bart said history and the Bible are not science. Well, I would argue with that. There is a lot of scientific thinking that goes into that reasoning. For example, in the Bible, you hear about this is what the original manuscript has. Turns out there is no original manuscript. If you study Christianity, it's not a surprise to you. So what they do is you have all these manuscripts from different times and periods and places and languages. And they piece them together using logic to discern what the original is. It's the same thing with evolution. You can look at DNA code. So there is a science to history, Bible. There is a deductive or logical reasoning that's very important. Also, I want to say that ideas come in bundles. And for example, Bart, he thinks, it's a young Earth, or the universe is 6,000 years old. There was a worldwide flood and all this. And that's why it's partly anti-evolutionist, because basically, it's not a modern scientific worldview. All the universities today accept evolution and teach it. Did you have anything?
Also the point that the world simply is only 6.5 years old. There is more than one piece of evidence showing the opposite. And I do believe, what is the alternative? How do you explain in a testable way the complexity, what we see out there? How do you make predictions? Neither the Bible nor theology makes a prediction of what kind of animals will we find still in the Amazon jungle and what kind we won't. We will not find an animal that has four legs and wings, because we know that front legs or arms have evolved into wings. So a Pegasus will not ever be found. We won't find one. That is a testable prediction. What predictions does the Bible make about the animals that we find in the Amazon? It doesn't make any.
Okay, so let's go to the Christian side for a response.
A couple points. Making predictions about what you find is not enough to justify being scientific. You have to show that that prediction was caused by your hypothesis. And I made that point in the slide. You show outcomes, but you don't show cause and effect relationship. And this touches upon your inference. You make a big point about inference. Inference has to be justified. Inference is making a generalized rule about multiple examples. For example, in medicine, if you get an infection after surgery, we assume based on we can infer it's from staph, not based on that particular case, but based on thousands of cases before that in which there was direct observation. Evolutionists misapply that. They use inference, but there are no previous examples to justify that inference. Then they claim their examples are microevolution, small changes like the E. coli. Well, I know that E. coli, it was by this fellow named Linsky, who grew it actually to 40,000. Yeah. And the only changes he noticed were increase in size and production and differences in carbon metabolism. And that's it. There was no change in complexity. There was no really fundamental difference between that E. coli and the E. coli of its parents. So that's a pure example of microevolution. And that is a huge big black hole in evolution, is they claim inference, but the inferences has no justification. The other thing is misapplication of tests. You do DNA tests to confirm evolution, but DNA tests have to be calibrated and confirmed with historical reference. We know the DNA is, judge relationship among DNA among related humans and related dogs because those have been tested against history. But there is no confirmation that these DNA tests can be used between species. So it's a misapplication of tests.
Okay, let's go to the other side.
There's one answer. The E. coli did change from a glucose-based to a citric acid-based carbon metabolism. I would call that a major change in complexity, and it is accepted as speciation. Is a little bit different, a little bit less easy than for species that actually multiply by a sexual process. There it's easier, you can say a dog and a wolf can still mate, so supposedly they should be the same species. There's discussion around that. A human and a chimp couldn't. There would not be any outcome or any fertile outcome out of those. To say you need to observe that is as saying you need to observe germs by your eyes with so that you can prove their existence. That is inference, that is part of it, and the processes of inference that are used, indeed, you make the example of DNA comparisons, those have been relied upon. We're currently adding a good 40,000 DNA discoveries a week to the database that we have, comparing the morphology, the phenotype, to what we find as a genotype coded in that genetic code of those animals. And not a single one of them is outside the phylogenetic tree that I showed on one of the slides. Not a single one of them shows that a bird all of a sudden is a salamander, or that a mammal all of a sudden is a fish. They all fall in it, and that's one of the predictions. And it has so far been tested millions of times without one simple falsification. For me, that is as much proof as millions of infections that happen just every single time that you cough on an open wound.
Okay.
Yeah, as far as cause and effect, an excellent example in evolution in DNA is pseudogenes, where, for example, us and chimps have shared busted genes, but the common ancestor doesn't. And you can see this, how they accumulate through ancestry. So it's really pretty obvious.
Okay, we're at 2 minutes there. So we get one last response from the Christian side of the panel.
Yeah, I know about all their examples. The pseudogenes, the way that's determined, they're genes that look similar to functioning genes in other animals. And the way they determine that, they just get lists of DNA from databases and see where they line up. And there's no demonstration that one evolved from the other. It's just assumed. You see different pieces of DNA that vary among creatures, but there's no demonstration that it's possible for one to evolve from the other by random changes, and there's no ancestral relationship. So again, you're assuming that since there's similarity, then it was due to evolution. But there's evolution has three factors. There's descent, modification, and common ancestry, and there's no demonstration of any of those 3 points. The other thing about the you talked about how DNA correlates with the phylogenetic tree. All that demonstrates is that DNA, the structure of DNA, correlates with how a creature looks, which is what we know by science. It has nothing to do with its origin. A real scientific, objective science says that DNA correlates with how it looks. It says nothing about its origin. Again, to show evolution, again, you can't infer it because there's no demonstrations that it can be derived through random mutation, natural selection. You gave the example of E. coli changing to its new, it's actually citrate as opposed to glucose. Yeah. Now, that is not a change. Now, the problem, and then you gave the wolf-dog example. The problem is nomenclature and these artificial divisions. Notice I didn't say that you can get different species. I said you couldn't get different species that could not mate with each other and have different complexity. That E. coli was not more complex. It was a change of one enzyme. It was not more enzymes.
Okay, so that concludes the second block. We're going to move once again into the question and answer. And so for question three, I'd like to ask Peter to pick, and again, this is a question for the Christian side of the panel, so a question towards Ron or Bart. Okay, will you go up to the, I think we've got somebody at the microphone.
Well, it's kind of for both sides. I think you have to have faith. You've heard this before, not have faith. And I think it would be more honest to call yourself agnostic, because really you can't prove it or disprove it. You can't. Same on the Christian side, you can't really prove it just because of faith. You've got to believe. You can't prove it.
Oh, okay.
So we'll leave this question for the atheist side, and we'll have another question following for the Christian side.
Okay. Yeah. Well, like I said, there's two ways to approach it. The Christian could say, here's evidence, and I would say that's poor evidence. The other way to approach it is I could say there's actually evidence against the God. Then you have to talk about what kind of God is it. There's a philosopher's God. There's Zeus. There's Jesus. There's the God of the Bible. You know, there's all kinds of different gods, and I believe there is evidence to disprove the God. So once you define God, for example, you say God's all good and all loving, then I can bring up some arguments to show that that's not true. So I think I disagree with you. I disagree with the sentiment that it can't be disproven either way.
Well, there's as many different opinions about Christianity as there are Christians. And there's many scientists that believe in God.
I think you're right, and that's what Richard Dawkins actually said. There's a scale from an absolute 100% believer to an agnostic that is 99.99% sure that there is no God, but there is a range in between where you can't prove. I think that's right. That's why I prefer to talk of myself as a humanist and not as an atheist, because that's what's important to me. A God is not, whatever God concept is not important for me, humans are.
Okay, we'll go to the next question. Do we have a question for the Christian side from the audience?
You know, in some circles, disbelieving evolution is a little bit like saying you believe in the Great Pumpkin or something like that. So the question, I guess, is a disbelief in evolution a requirement in your mind to be believing in God?
Great question.
Is disbelieving a requirement to believe in God? So the converse is that if you believe in evolution, there is no God.
I'm asking you. So
okay, I'm just rephrasing the question. If there were evolution, is there God? No, I agree with you. If there were evolution, there could be no God. Because God isn't required to create things. The Bible says God created everything. And now some people believe in both. Some people believe God used evolution to create God. There was God that created some simple cell, and then through evolution, it became everything, all other living creatures. I don't believe that's possible. Now, for me, that's a moot point. For me, evolution is, I'm pretty convinced it's a pseudoscience, and it's just with the new science we know about how cells work and DNA, it's a pretty absurd theory that should go away, like the sun. We used to believe the sun revolved around the earth.
Okay,
so it's a moot point for me.
Stop there. Okay, so that concludes the
entirety of the presentation.
We'll turn it back over to Ron.
All right.
Well, thank you guys. Thanks, Bart. Thanks, Truman. Thanks, Chris.
John.
And Amy. What do you guys think? You want to do this again sometime? Something like this?
I have a question.
Oh, we're out of time, Jeanette.
I'm wondering if they think they're going to live after, where do they go after they die?
All right.
Same place you came from.
Okay. Did you ever know, I think that I will believe in Jesus because Jesus is
Okay, so we're out of time, and we're going to close our service with, I'd like you to take your program if you received it when you came in. And there's things that's welcome. We're glad you're here. I'd love to have everybody fill one of these out. We'd like to know that you're here.